Hi everyone, thanks for being there. Thanks Martin for your presentation. I'm Simone, a new postdoctoral researcher at Loughborough University, Geography and Environment Department. And with this presentation, I would like to share with you my research interest, my background, and my ongoing project. The presentation is structured, it should be well organized in four chapters, not like my English, I'm sorry. It's structured in the first chapter, a little bit about myself, about my background, and then I would like to present a couple of papers related with biological invasion that I'm pretty proud of. And finally, the last part will be about my ongoing project at Loughborough University. In fact, I'm Italian. However, I spent my last 9 years in Spain. And this is basically my life, at least my academic life. After a master's degree in Parma, and I moved to University of Murcia in south of Spain, but my academic route has a deviation. After my PhD in 2015 in aquatic ecology at Murcia University, I work a couple of years in a private company in Seville, an environmental consulting firm that was in charge of river biomonitoring networks. And then from Seville, I decided to change, and I came back to the academia thanks to the possibility offered me by the Newton Fellowship. Briefly, my job at the private company. The private company was in charge of two official river biomonitoring network, the Guadalquivir River Basin in the south and the Ebro River Basin in the north. My job was basically focused on river biomonitoring and focusing on different bioindicators from diatoms, macrophyte, macroinvertebrate, and fish, implementing the European Water Framework Directive. During these years, my teams visit around 500 river sites around Spain. It was pretty interesting, let's see. But it was not easy to do research. This is basically me proposing stuff to my boss, for example. Obviously, the research and scientific article was not a priority, and probably this was one of the reasons that affect my decision to move. However, joking apart, during this experience, we were able to update the current node distribution of some invertebrates around the entire Iberian Peninsula, and for example, a mayfly, a stonefly, and a caddyfly. So in 2018, I decided to change, and I came back to the academia, let's see, to my former university, University of Murcia, and I collaborated to the European Life Project Ripisilva Natura. That is an interesting project focused on restoration ecology on the riparian area of the Segura River Basin, south of Spain. Sorry, but it doesn't work very well. So the project was focused on assess and measure restoration to assess the restoration measure designed to control the invasive Arundodonax that you can see in the photo, because Arundodonax is indeed among the 100 most dangerous invasive species worldwide, with some problem at different scale, but some problem even for biodiversity and economic impact. For example, along the riparian habitat suffer a complete biomodernization with a reduction in riparian vegetation and biodiversity in general. An article has been recently accepted about the monitoring of this European project in water. Arundodonax has not just related with biodiversity. There is also economic impact. Images is from the same area, south of Spain. We may observe that during the flooding episode, most of the material that affect the river flowing is Arundodonax that basically fill all the gaps under the bridge. The river can flow properly, with the catastrophic effect, especially upstream. This is a bridge, and it's completely filled by this invasive species. This here's some example of different measure and treatment that are being tested with different kind of planning. And the interesting stuff about this project is also that there is a multi-taxon approach. We study riparian vegetation, birds, macroinvertebrates, and even European otter, for example. But I'm not going to explain to talk a lot about this project, but we can discuss later if you are interested. Indeed, this was an example of the interest that is currently increasing on biological invasion. Numerous European projects are going on. For example, this is just one example, Ripisilva Natura, about the riparian area, but there is also a new life project, European life project, that called Infasacqua, where I collaborate with, that is basically focused on aquatic species, not just riparian area. It is more ambitious, it's on the entire Iberian Peninsula, and specifically on aquatic species. There are news on the newspaper, no? On the BBC about the biological invasion. Also, there's an increase in interest. There's also a specific cost action from the European Union about to better understanding the alien species. To increase our understanding on the alien species, also because no saturation, the accumulation of alien species worldwide has been detected, and without forget the new report of the IPBES, the stress invasive species among the most important driver of change in nature worldwide. So there is an increased interest in biological invasion. And my interest started in 2011 when during a field work in South Spain we detected this corixid, this little water box, 5 millimeters, along the coast of Spain and Portugal. And we classify this water box like Trichocorixa verticalis, that is a North American species. This is the native distribution in green and the invaded distribution in red. But again, my interest started there, but I was not interested in the species concretely, specifically. I'm not an expert in emitteran taxonomy, for example. But I was interested in some questions that arise from this record. By the way, numerous papers have been published, a number of PhD studies have been discussed after our record that was pretty new and revolutionary in some way, because the only record was in South Africa and New Caledonia, and it was from the 70s, and we update definitely the current no invaded distribution. But again, I was not interested in this species concretely, specifically. I was particularly interested in the question behind. And the question is, Trichocorixa is basically one of the few, or probably the only one, invasive aquatic insect. Why there are not aquatic insect? Just basically this species and some mosquito, if you think. So, and I want to present this paper that was very interesting in my opinion, that where we discuss and we present this paradox. The paradox that we call a paradox, the fact about freshwater ecosystem and aquatic insect. It was published in Biology Letter in 2016, led by Stefano Fenoglio. And a curiosity about this paper is that the idea came up during my viva, and most of the authors were my external evaluator, for example. So maybe even today we can obtain a good idea during our discussion and try to do something together. The title was Freshwater Ecosystem and Aquatic Insect, a Paradox in Biological Invasion. And the idea is clear. Insects are among the most invasive taxa worldwide, and freshwater ecosystems are among the most invaded system. However, taking into account the unparalleled taxonomic diversity of insects and the unparalleled functional diversity of insects, there are almost no invasive aquatic insects in freshwater. sound complicated, but it's not so complicated. Some numbers, some data about that. As you know, insects dominate in every biogeographic region in terms of number of species, but there are almost no invasive species in freshwater belonging to the insecta group. So which are successful invaders in freshwater? They are basically mollusks and crustaceans, things about Potamopyrgus antipodarum, Scorbicula fluminea, or Dreissena polymorpha among mollusks, or things about different kinds of crayfish, from Passifasta culeniscalus, the Cygna crayfish, to the Procambarus clarki. Or think about fish, like the giant Silurus, for example, or even the aquatic flora. Think about water hyacinth or Azolla fuliculoides. And this is an impressive photo, in my opinion. This is the Spanish army at the boundary with Portugal, but not with bad intention, just removing water hyacinth from the Guadiana River that set the political boundary between this country. No need to mention the economic cost of this operation that are repeated basically every year. So we discuss this topic in our paper in Biology Letter, and we provide six main reasons about this paradox. We will see one by one now. Hope not to be too boring. Basically, the economic interest in moving aquatic insects is very scarce, and as you know, the greater the economic interest in the species, the higher possibility to travel, and currently no commercial value is known for aquatic insects. If you think about chironomids for aquatic fish food, they are basically frozen. Or if you think in the increasing interest in insects as human food, it's true, but they're essentially terrestrial insects. They seem easier to grow and to have better nutritive compositions. We should definitely try. It's very rare the case of some aquatic insect used in human food. There are some examples recorded in Mexico and Thailand, for example, of some water bugs or water beetles, for example. Most of them are terrestrial insects like Lepidoptera, terrestrial Coleoptera, Orthoptera, Hymenoptera. Also, you can find terrestrial insect in some specific web page or platform for selling stuff, probably because they are charismatic due to their size. For example, why you can find is difficult, or you cannot find aquatic insect in this kind of web page. Again, the association between aquatic insect and host plant are rare, and travel together is always easy and better. Again, there are a lot of terrestrial examples. Think about the spread over long distance with the wood and timber trade. And while there is basically no aquatic example, there is just a semi-aquatic example, that is Tenophelmus rufinatus, that live associated with Azolla fluticoides. And both are alien in Europe and the UK, and is probably related to their spread. I mean, their spread is probably related to the interest of Azolla fuliculoides in aquarium activity and fresh fish keeping activity, for example. Well, in the terrestrial example, it's possible even a multiple association, like pinus, like the different species of pinus, monocambus, that is a genus of beetles, and the nematode associated with the beetles, and this. This is the invasive species that spread from US to Asia and Europe now. It's like a third travel mate, not just one, they travel in a group, not just in couple. Again, aquatic insects usually lack the adaptation for overland and maritime transport. If you think about the different potential pathway that may help in spreading a species, just a few can be applied to aquatic insects, and are those related to aquaculture trade or ship ballast water. And to And even these two examples, aquaculture and sheep bala water, need specific traits and adaptation for grasping and clinging, or to resist, to survive high level of salinity or low quality water. And this is extremely uncommon in aquatic insects, while it's extremely common in crustaceans or mollusks. For example, think about different kind of micro or macro crustaceans that can travel inside ballast water, or mollusk or macro algae that can easily survive in biofouling layers, even numerous days in a dry condition. Again, linking with the paper of Trichocorixa. Trichocorixa verticalis is the only known aquatic insect that can be considered alien, and it's also aquatic in all its stages, from the eggs to the adult, it's aquatic. And it's interesting to compare the map I showed at the beginning, that is the current known distribution of Trichocorixa verticalis, and the the global maritime transport routes. Because Trichocorixa verticalis is an aerial species. It's able to survive high level of salinity. And if you pay attention, all the records is around the Strait of Gibraltar. I shouldn't touch. The Strait of Gibraltar, both in the Spanish part or the Moroccan part. Always on the western part of the Strait of Gibraltar. And Strait of Gibraltar is a hotspot in maritime transport. It's a very dense, point, high hotspot in maritime transport. And we suggest that this fact can be related, because it's a common procedure in maritime transport, for example, that the ballast water are usually empty before entering the Mediterranean Sea. Because the Mediterranean Sea is considered a more stable environment in terms of wave and climate, so it's a common procedure that the ballast water are empty before entering the Mediterranean Sea. And our records was the entire data set was on the Atlantic coast of Spain, Portugal, and Morocco. So we kind of discussed these patterns and speculate in a little bit in our paper. Published in PLOS ONE 2013. Well, moving on, other point. The fourth is that aquatic insects seem to have less reproductive, less diverse, the reproductive strategy than terrestrial one. For example, parthenogenic reproduction, that is characteristic of some terrestrial terrestrial invertebrates, is absent in aquatic insect. And as you know, high reproduction is a key trait. If you want to colonize a new habitat, because of the advantages during the dispersal phases, evident. Again, point five: aquatic insects usually have an aquatic and terrestrial stage, except some Hemiptera or Coleoptera. They have to find the ideal condition in both environments, the aquatic and the terrestrial, and taking into account the air phases, the terrestrial stage is very short and basically dedicated to reproduction. This fact undermines the possibility of spread and the invasion of aquatic insects. The last one is related to the point number five, and it's an eco-evolutionary reason in our opinion. In fact, aquatic insects, most of the aquatic insects live in lotic environment, like things about river or stream, and lotic species have a low dispersal capacity because they are highly adapted to this flowing water condition, and this can be a disadvantage in their capacity of spread toward new and different aquatic environment. Here's an example of some mayfly or caddyfly that are highly adapted to flowing water condition. They need the water. They need this condition. They cannot travel in ballast water, for example, or other kind of standing water environment, for example. So my interest in bioindicator and biomonitoring and invasive species brought me to write a complete overview of challenges and constraints represented by invasive species in biomonitoring that has been recently published in Science of the Total Environment, plus the Newton Fellowship proposal at Loughborough University, both with the collaboration of Paul Wood, and we will see later that this manuscript, let's see, this topic are related. And here I want to move to this review that has been recently published in Science of Total Environment, where we stress new challenges, new constraints represented by these non-native species when you want to calculate in the biomonitor index in a river ecosystem. So briefly, one slide of introduction about biomonitoring using macroinvertebrates, or maybe you already know most of this stuff, but briefly, macroinvertebrate-based index are globally the most widely used biomonitoring tool in river ecosystem, usually a family level with a score approach. However, little is known about the implication of new non-native species on the reliability of this macroinvertebrate-based index, and obviously error in correct classification of the exclusion or the exclusion of updated nomenclature may affect the ecological status evaluation with problem in restoration project and aquatic conservation in general. And if we think about alien invertebrate species in river, many questions need to be answered. What can we do about invasive species when biomonitoring? Are there any hidden effects? Or how does the presence of a species may affect the biotic index calculation and reliability, for example? However, don't panic. We know stuff. We already know that in river ecosystem, invaders are not a random selection of species. As I mentioned before, mollusks and crustacea are among the most common invaders in freshwater ecosystem. We already know about the consequence and the implication of, for example, signal crayfish, Passifasta culinistacul, on British rivers and British biomonitoring tools, thanks to the brilliant research of Matters and collaborators, or McNeil and collaborators, in England and Central Europe. However, doing a complete overview of currently used biomonitor index around Europe, we still detect 9 constraints that are very specifically, but most of them are related again with mollusk and crustacean, for example. I don't want to, there is no need to speak about this point in this case, but basically these 9 constraints that we stressed represent new challenges for bioassessment in general, and they can be summarized in three main categories. In fact, the invasive species and alien species can be dominant with problem when you want to interpret the results in biomonitoring. Invasive species and native species can share the same family, and this is a problem if we use an index based calculated at family level. And also there is some problem related to taxonomic changes and cryptic species that sometimes are difficult to detect for not expert operator or out of dated operator. We will see now some example.
So just people might not be familiar with biomonitoring, so this is a framework where each species or family, in many cases, of invertebrate, is given a score, and you get a site level score, and that site level score should tell you about the quality of the environment.
Yeah.
But maybe not if one invasive species comes in and changes.
Yeah, how to manage these species into when you are performing biomonitoring, when you are monitoring, how to use these species, because we don't have a score for these species, we don't know the effect of these species, and the presence of an alien species is like a shift from a reference condition. That is the main aim to in the European Free Water Directive, is to compare our condition with a reference condition. So, yes. Yes, I should introduce better probably the topic. However, I work in a private company, I work in the academia, so I suffer on my skin this problem, how to to consider how to consider this, the presence of this species when you when the boss or the river authority want the ecological status evaluation of this river. So we detect 9 problems that can be summarized in 3 topic, and we can see now some example. For example, for instance, case of species that share the same family. The family Astacidae, for example, we have the invasive species Passifasta gulenisticus, that is signal crayfish, called signal crayfish, but we also have in the same family the protected one, Austropotamobius pallipes, that is in the annex 2 of the habitat directive, European habitat directive, for example. So, but if we calculate the index at family level, we overlook the presence of the species. We miss something, in my opinion. Or again, the other family that we can share invasive species or native species, and they're pretty similar, so it's important the operator should be not expert, in my opinion, but completely updated. It's not a question of age, to be expert or not to be expert, but it's a question to be updated or not updated about taxonomic changes and about how the species distribution is changing now at worldwide. So you need to stay updated. If this new species is into the UK, for example, and stuff. And again, the example of Coryxidae, we have Trichocrysa verticale invasive species, we have Cigara there, a native genus, and they are pretty similar. You have to pay attention. Or other example about the problem related with the cryptic species or dominant species. Think about this freshwater gastropod that was recently published in Conservation Genetics, that in Japan, Ferritia japonica, that is this species, thanks to new genetic technique, have been discovered to be an alien species, Ferritia californica. So currently this species is in the endangered species list, but it shouldn't be in the endangered species list because it's an alien species. So again, research is faster than legislation, probably. But it's a problem, again, if you are an operator in a private company or in a river basin authority, it's a problem how to manage the presence of this species. Or the case of dominance. Think about, these are dead shell of Corbicula fluminia that completely modified the riverbed with problem during the fieldwork and the potential impact on the community in general. So what can we do about this species when biomonitoring? Well, first of all, a biomonitoring report may be a quantitative source of biological invasion detection. Can be useful because most of the time operator or technician report in observation space the presence of the species. Could be useful for an early warning, an early detection, but obviously it is not enough. It is not enough. So we can ignore the species, but it's the simplest way, but can be not very useful in my opinion, because if they are dominant, like in this case, it's difficult to ignore, to ignore them, because sometimes you can have problem when interpreting data. Problem has been stressed in Netherlands, Germany, and other country, for example, about the difficulty to reach the minimal total number for organisms for the index calculation, because site is completely in case that site is completely invaded, for example. We can apply a negative score maybe when we detect this alien species. It's an option worthy of further study, in my opinion. It could be an interesting option. For example, in fish-based method in Italy, called Nisezzi in Italian, I'm sorry, the presence of non-native hybrid species or hybrid species is penalizing the final index score. But it's just one of the few examples. A German index and the Italian fish-based methods. Maybe could be interesting or worthy of further study to apply an adaptive score of the family level. If the native species are present, the original score can be applied. If the alien species is detected, A reduced score should be used probably, but again it depends on the operator and the technician, their skills basically. We can apply positive score maybe. Some researchers in Germany stress that every single species can be used in bioassessment, no matter if they are exotic or indigenous or native. Easier for me. And very interesting point. I will discuss this point at the end. But currently, I need to say that it's a tricky point because the tolerance to anthropogenic pressure remain poorly evaluated for these alien species that are changing constantly. Also, it's not every year the same because species distribution is varying constantly due to different factors, among which the climate change, for example. And also to apply a positive score, in my opinion, is a little bit in contrast with the core concept of the Water Framework Directive reference condition that usually consider the presence of alien species a shift from the reference condition that we want to achieve, that we aim to achieve. So it's a tricky point. What we can do and what we suggested was to apply a specific new metric that is focused 100% on assessing the biocontamination and maybe integrate this index with other indexes in a multimetric approach. Arbatsouskas and collaborators 10 years ago present something similar on Rhine and Danube rivers in Central and East Europe. This index could be a useful starting point. One thing that is easy to obtain and should be very interesting is a short list of invaders that must be classified at lower taxonomic level. This should be done by each river basin authority, for example, and update at least yearly at national basin level. This list will help in avoiding the presence of these alien species being overlooked, for example, will help the operator. It's something that I learned during my period in the private company, for example. However, we are aware that everything that we propose or we discuss are going to have some consequence on the threshold about among ecological status or intercalibration process. But you need to think that significant changes have occurred in freshwater ecosystem during the last 20 years when the Water Framework Directive first came into operation. And most of these changes are related to the presence of new species and to modification in the species distribution. So this paper, where we discuss, we perform like an overview of constraints and new challenges for biomonitoring was very important, at least for me, because represent in some way the theoretical framework that was behind my current project, that is the Newton International Fellowship. Briefly, the Newton International Fellowship is a scheme that aims to dedicated to postdoctoral researchers that want to have a postdoctoral period in the UK, and they are not scared by Brexit, which is like the second second option. And after this paper, we represent the theoretical framework. We wrote down the project. The title was quite ambitious. Was the effect of biological invasion on the ecological integrity of rivers and biomonitor indices, identifying challenges and predicting the consequence. We were lucky. We were got financed from this year to 2021. And now I'm going to move to this part of the presentation that is presenting my ongoing project at Loughborough University. The project focuses on two main issues, mesocosmos and experiment on one end and large data set analysis on the other end. Today I want to speak about large dataset analysis. However, a paper is currently under review in Biological Invasion about the desiccation resistance traits of Curbicula fluminia in British rivers. But today I want to speak about the other part, the large dataset analysis that we perform thanks to the data provided by the Environment Agency. Dataset analysis that we would perform in a before-after control impact approach, that is a common approach to evaluate, for example, the impact of an infrastructure or a construction, but in this case was just considering the entry of a new species in the community, the impact. So we aim to focus on different species. We start the second chapter, let's see, of my fellowship, focusing on Dicrogammarus imobafes, and we test four biomonitoring index currently used by the Environment Agency. We test the WHPT index, that is the index, new index, by the way, from 2014, and is currently used for ecological assessment of British River. I mean, it's a big fish index, because for the assessing of the ecological status is the index chosen by England. It's direct derivative, that is WHPT-ASPT. It's very complicated, that is, but it's very easy to calculate it. That is the index WHPT divided by the number of scored taxa. The PSI index, that is a proportion of sensitive sediment-sensitive invertebrate, let's see, a macroinvertebrate-based tool for measuring sedimentation impact, and the life index, that is a macroinvertebrate-based tool for measuring flow alteration. Typical biomonitor index currently used on every day by the environmental agency. We also aim to test complementary metrics based on functional measures, like functional richness and functional redundancy, for example. And kind of premiere, first time on the screens, the title of this chapter will be something like that: implication of an invasive species on taxonomics and functional diversity in rivers. Briefly, to present the star, is we focus on Dicrogammarus imobafes, commonly called diamond shrimp in UK. It is native from the Ponto-Caspian region, first recorded in Britain in May 2012. So we split the large dataset we obtained from Environmental Agency that is composed by the last 20 years. We split the dataset in two parts: before the arrival of the species from 2000 to 2011, and after the arrival of the species from 2013 to last spring, 2019. In England, there are currently around 90 sites where river sites where Environment Agency detect the species, with a total of 1,500 samples, most of them collected in spring and autumn. We also have data from more than 150 control sites for a total of 4,000 samples. And all this data set allow us to work with a complete set of more than 8 million of individuals. So for people that don't know this, the species, why the species is so good at being bad? Well, they're very fecund, they present a wide salinity and temperature tolerance, they are opportunistic but also omnivore, and predator in some case, and very aggressive in mesocosm. This behavior has been described. And they can survive outside the water even around 6 days. So they seem to have the traits that aquatic insects lack, that I mentioned before. And it can easily spread via sailing rope, diving equipment, or ballast water, together with the Resina polymorpha that is there, that came from the same region, the Ponto-Caspian region, for example. So this is some preliminary result about the taxonomic metric currently used by environment agency, considering the invaded sites, applying a linear mixed model, considering site as a random effect. And we can observe an increase in life index and ISPT index and a decrease in WHPT. It's not so clear when we put the data together, but believe me, there is an increase on this data, a significant increase in this index, the life index and ISPT, and a decrease in the WHPT, the index used for assessing ecological status of British River. If we split the data set and focus just on autumn, 600 sample, for example, the effect are even stronger and wider. We can observe a decrease from before to after, a significant decrease of around 11 points. It's an important decrease that may even affect the ecological status of a site. And if a site is going to change the ecological status, it means that the environment agency or river basin authority need to do something, need to apply some restoration measures for maintain the aquatic conservation. So it's very, very important this finding. However, this is just a before and after approach. I mentioned before that we aim to do a complete before-after control impact approach. In this case, we put together the response of we add the behavior, the response of more than 4,000 control sites here in red. In general, we can observe a decrease in the invaded sites that are on blue, and constant level in the control sites in both autumn and spring. If we put together all this data, we have around 6,000 data. We scale the value of the index. We may observe a similar starting point and a completely different trend. Control site display a significant increase after the invasion. So with data from 2013 to 2019, last summer, while invaded the sites display a significant decrease in the same period. And it's pretty rigorous, at least in my opinion, because we use control site, it's very rigorous. We use control site from same area, same period, same climatic area, and most of the time same basin, mostly Trent and Thames basin. So something is happening, focusing on the WHPT index. However, we aim to obtain this plot that I obtained last week for all the taxonomic metric. For this reason, just preliminary result. I focus just on this index this morning. But we aim to obtain a similar plot for all the metrics. Why we want to focus also on functional measures? Well, because there is an increasing interest in functional measures nowadays, and also because functional focus allow us to go behind just a taxonomic description of the community and have a more complete overview of the river condition. Functional measure, in fact, seems geographically generalizable. They don't depend on a specific or local species. Functional measures are related to stressor or ecosystem resistance, and functional measures allow an inter-taxon comparability. We can compare the behavior of the functional richness obtained with diatoms and the functional richness obtained with the macroinvertebrate community, for example. We focus on functional richness following the methods proposed by Villager and collaborator, and on functional redundancy following the calculation methods proposed by Pilar, Bruno, and others. We use biological traits from a dataset that is freshwaterecology.info at genus level. What is a functional measure of biological traits? Well, we use a fancy code approach, giving some score at each taxon, but not depending on the taxon, but depending on the functional characteristics. So The biological trait in take into account were, for example, sites, locomotion, food, feeding habits, and so on. And if we focus on the results, on the functional measures, we have again a decrease in functional redundancy now before after context. We have a significant decrease of the functional richness. And if we focus on the functional redundancy, again, we have a significant reduction. And if we put together the data, we scale all the data, we take into account 6,000 data, we found the similar behavior, the similar response that we found before. Even if the starting point is not the same, there is a contrasting patterns. Control site response in a way, and invaded site react in an opposite way. So there is something is happening. So take home message about this part. WHPT seems sensitive to the invasion. Lower value have been obtained when Dichrogammarus hemobuffus appear. However, if you remember at the beginning, two index behave in the opposite trend. They increase after the arrival of this new species. They were ASPT index and life index. And so care should be taken when interpreting these results when Dichrogammarus hemobuffus is present, because sample seems subject to a statistical inflation following in the invasion. And we speculate, we discuss that this is probably due to an active production of this aggressive species on some low score taxa. We detect a seasonal effect, with stronger effect in summer and autumn samples, with a decrease of around 11 points in case of WHPT that is a relevant decrease that may affect even the ecological status classification of the river, of our rivers. We detect also implication on the functioning of in-stream macroinvertebrate community, because we observe that both functional measures applied, functional richness and functional redundancy, significantly decrease. And generally speaking, bioassessment science need to be open to improvement, and current tool and protocol need to be flexible so they can be rapidly and easily updated to allow nice new scientific knowledge to be integrated. Think about taxonomy change, new species, new traits, new score, and new metrics. I'm going very fast, I'm seeing. It's not finished, however.
There? This? No, WHPT.
Ah, okay. It's the index currently used for environment agency to evaluate the ecological status of the river. So obviously we don't want a decrease. Mm-hmm. Okay, because following this index, we are going to classify our river in good status, moderate status, or bad status. So this is the tools that England choose for biomonitoring assessment.
Can you just give me an idea? So I'm a social scientist, okay, just as background. So can you give me an idea approximately of, like, you know, what kind of things, maybe you mentioned it, but I just really
didn't understand.
Which kind of things are being taken into account?
Yeah, it's just you go to the river, there is a protocol that you have to follow during the field work. You obtain your sample. Your sample of macroinvertebrates, or invertebrates like insects, crustacea, or mollusks, and every taxa, it's the correct way. I can't change that. As is associated with a score, and the index is basically the sum of these scores, modified by the abundance. The scores are affected by the abundance. So at the end, we are going to the Thames in London, and we will find 20 family. Every family has a score. The final value is the sum of the score.
Yeah.
That maybe to give you an idea, can be maybe from 0 to like 300 or something, or 200. If well preserved site may have value of around 200 or even even more. So in this case, there is a for example, the median value is around 100, and there is a control site without the species doesn't react. From 2000 to last spring, there was any significant change. While in we focus on invaded site, there is a significant change. So something is happening since the species arrived. And we may observe this pattern, even we can observe this pattern, not just on this widely used biomonitoring tool, but also in new metric like functional richness or functional redundancy. But a couple of index display a completely opposite pattern that are ISPT and life, and we need to investigate why. Probably we speculate, we discuss about a selective production of these species on other taxa, so they can maybe they can have a predatory activity just on some taxa, and in this way affecting the these two index.
This is politically and economically important.
Or no.
Good ecological status or not. And if we're not.
If not, restoration measure have to be applied. So this is the interest of environment agency on our research, I think, so because they want to know what's happening now with all these new species. It's a problem, it's not a problem. Well, the title of my presentation was very challenging, exploring new challenges in a changing world, and I want to stress also, and at least mention this other paper and other topics, because some species in a river can be between the hammer and the anvil, because both invasive species and climate change are among the most important drivers of change in nature, and they can even interact. Global change and the presence of invasive species, so maybe global change driver. I want to leave there in this academic forum some question, basically. And my question, my doubts about all of this topic is that global change may bring definitely to numerous climate winner, climate loser species in distribution worldwide. There is a relevant bibliography already done. I don't discover anything here. But so, in my opinion, climate change, let's think even together, climate change will start, at least in some cases, to delay the boundary between native and alien, because everything is moving so fast, and the species distribution worldwide is moving so fast due to direct transport by human or indirect transport or climate change, just moving toward a new better condition. I will talk about some example later. So do we need to face that and rethink the label of and our attitude toward alien species? Indeed, these are open challenges for everyone. Everyone has different ideas. There are a lot of publications about that. And this is an interdisciplinary field, in my opinion, between physical geography and human geography. We are working also in this topic with some human geographer now about migration, for example, at Lopro. Human migration, I mean. Because, for example, food for thought. Red fox moving from rivers. I can speak about more stuff, not just river, but I mean, I'm a stream ecologist. Red fox now, like thinks about Russia, Poland, and East Europe, seems to follow its habitat into a warming Arctic, and for the first time competitively excluding the Arctic fox. Something similar happened through, again, a river example, Tritemis kirby, a dragonfly that is originated from the arid area of Africa, North Africa. And now it's currently recorded in Spain, at least I recorded in Spain, in France, and in Italian island. Due to the drier summer, have been increasingly recorded along the Iberian Peninsula and in the other. So are they alien species? Are they climate migrants, climate travelers? It's an open question. Indeed, this species has not a an impact on the native community. Probably because it's just, I don't know. We don't know a lot of stuff about it. It's probably the first step of the invasion. Authors like Hill and Hadley stress that we need to rethink completely our definition of native or invasive in the Anthropocene era, where everything is moving so fast, the world, the transport, and even the biological system. And there is a relevant example of introduced prey species, like such alien crayfish, the first I show you at the beginning, Procambarus clarki, that obviously are highly detrimental for numerous species and also for the turbidity of the ecosystem. But now, after long years of invasion, they are crucial in the food chain, in numerous predator native community. It's the case of water birds in wetlands. The native predator community of water birds depend on the presence of some alien crayfish. So it's the paradox of the long-term positive effect of a North American crayfish on a European community of predator. So maybe we shouldn't consider all species in the same way. Exception should be done. As I mentioned, a lot of stuff need to be investigated. Further analysis, new approach, interdisciplinary study are highly recommended, in my opinion. And however, we need to take into account, and in my opinion, in ecology, for example, the best answer of all these questions sometimes is the answer that bring a new and stimulating question, like a kind of paradox. And that's all. Thanks for your attention.